Good afternoon, everyone, and a warm welcome to this funeral service for Margaret MacKay. Dalbeg passed away on Saturday, and on behalf of this congregation, where she was a very active and much loved member for many years, I wish to express our condolences to the family, to Katrina, Joan, husbands Donnie and Chris, and the rest of this lovely family gathered with you today. And this is also a service of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving to God for her life, for all that she meant to her family and her many friends, and for all she contributed to those who lived here in the community and in far off places. And very importantly, we remember for the legacy of good works. For these and much more, she will be remembered. And as a people of Christian faith, we have cause to celebrate the passing of her life into the heavenly realm, which is the destination of all who are believers and who have walked the path of faith, committed Christians all her life, and so she has entered into her reward. And these are key elements and as expressions of our service today. For we mourn, yes, but not as those without hope, for we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep. And we are to encourage one another with these words. Welcome to all of you who have come across the island and maybe from further afield to show your support to the family and to express your affection for Margaret. The family are very grateful for your presence here today. And the service is being live streamed, and it will be of great benefit to some, maybe many, who are unable to be here. And so we welcome you very much to our service. And after the interment at Dalmore, you're all, if possible, invited to come back for refreshments and chat and share with the family, share your memories, and just have that bond of community this afternoon. So feel free to do that. And as is the normal practice in most of our services, we begin with the family eulogy and tribute, because we're focusing on the person. And so it's my privilege to read that, and just to also notice that the praise and all the readings that we have today have been chosen by the family. So here's the family tribute to a special lady. Margaret MacKay, 1934 to 2023. Born in Argyll, Margaret began her working life as a midwife in Glasgow. She moved to Lewes to become a district nurse in the 1950s, little knowing that she had found her home. She left her career when she married Murdo MacArthur in 1961, and they set up their home in Dalbeg. Turning their hands to weaving, they gathered the finances to start a dairy, which she eventually expanded to deliver milk from Ness to Uig. Her nursing skills and farming background were still put to good use when the vet was unavailable, as she could be called out at all hours to assist with sick animals across the west side. With one daughter and another on the way, they moved into a new house they had built in the village. Sadly, Murdo was tragically killed in a car accident only a few months after the birth of their second child. Never one to be thwarted by adversity, Margaret continued delivering milk until the mid-1970s. She married Angus MacKay in 1979 when both her families were grown, and he settled with her in Dalbeg, where they spent happy years until his passing in 1987. In 1976, she started a minibus run taking Carloway students to the Nicholson Institute, so they no longer needed to stay in a hostel. This evolved into Dalbeg coaches, which serviced the West Side Run, and much else besides. Throughout this time, she guided tourists around the island and drove Wallace Arnold and Shearing's coaches to give their drivers a day off. She was also responsible for organizing coach tours for the many cruise ships which had begun to call into Stornoway. Having grown up in the Brethren Church, Margaret became a Christian who took her faith seriously. She struggled to find an English service after moving to Dalbeg until the Reverend Jack MacArthur became the minister in Carloway Church of Scotland and began an early morning English service every Sunday. Margaret became an active member of the church and a lifelong close friend of Jack and his wife, Kathy. Her involvement in the local church and community extended to working with the Women's Guild, the Girl Guides, and Council Social Work Committee. She pioneered an old folks' Christmas dinner in Shawbust when these were not commonplace on the island. and was involved in setting up a Meals on Wheels service for the elderly in the community. She later drove the minibus for the Sunshine Club in Carloway and was affronted when the time came that she was asked to join the ranks. Always up for a challenge and ever ready for an opportunity to try out the controls of another mode of transport, and having virtually exhausted the list of ground-based vehicles from a scooter to a coach and everything in between, she was delighted on her 60th birthday to discover she'd been gifted a short flight behind the controls of a small plane and took to the sky, thankfully landing safely at the end of her first flying lesson. Somehow she found the time to be a keen traveler, making trips to Israel, Europe, the United States, and Canada, forging lasting friendships with those she met. It was Romania, however, that always held a special place in her heart. It first came to her attention when she was asked to take a busload of aid there in the late 80s. Ever since that first fateful journey, she felt compelled to return, sometimes making multiple trips a year. Her buses would be stripped of their seats and packed with aids and toys for the children of the orphanages. She built enduring relationships with Romanian friends who remained in touch even when she could no longer travel. On one memorable occasion, she was held at gunpoint by Hungarian border guards as they ransacked the bus and helped themselves to anything of value. Ever fearless, she didn't spare them her customary sharp tongue, and the dictionary was frantically searched to find a translation for "you brats." Her charitable work and contributions to the community led her to attending three Queen's Garden parties, and she was delighted to be seated next to Her Majesty at lunch the last time she was on the island. She was also honored with an award from the Rotary Club that had hitherto been reserved only for men. In her later years, as Parkinson's and the accompanying dementia took their toll, she had to be cared for, just as she had always faithfully done for others. For the last 5 years of Margaret's life, she was a resident of Blarbuja Nursing Home in Stornoway, where she was well cared for during a time of declining health, which she bore with her usual resilience. It was obvious to all the family that although not engaging in much conversation, that she still had perfect hearing, as she always enjoyed her visits and was very much a part of the crack that went on around her. It was compassion for others that drove her all her life, and she shared her home with any who needed it. Margaret didn't see problems. She just saw things she hadn't turned her attention to yet. She was fearless. She was joyous. She was kind. She was Margaret Dalbeg. That's wonderful. Let's give her a round of applause. Much for that moving contribution. So we're going to begin the next part of the service by singing Psalm 23, chosen by the family.
My shepherd, I
think I've ever heard it sung more beautifully than that today. So the first reading is from Psalm 16, verses from 5 to 11. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The bounded lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely, I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure. Because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful ones see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. And then in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 to 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Amen. May God bless us. The reading of his word to us. So let's have a short prayer. Let's bow our heads and our hearts in prayer. Lord God in heaven, our times are in your hands. From first cry to final breath, for you are the giver and the sustainer of life. We celebrate a new birth and mourn the passing of a precious life, as we have gathered here to express. Yet our sorrow is cushioned by the comfort we have of knowing Margaret's strong faith has kept her through all her days, bright days and darker ones in later life. The love of her family has been an immeasurable strength and resource to her through times of weakness and decline. For all these blessings, we give you thanks. For how the words of the psalm have surely been fulfilled, that the Lord is now her eternal portion, and she has indeed inherited a delightful inheritance. For you have made known to her the path of life, and with you she will find eternal pleasures at your right hand. We pray that this would be the portion of all who are here today, that we would all make sure of our eternal calling by putting a trust in the one who will never leave us or forsake us, the one who will take us through life's journey as the shepherd of our souls. For those closest to Margaret, Katrina, Joan, and their loved ones, we ask that this day would be a source of comfort and a treasured memory of the love and respect the community have shown their mother over many years. We ask that your hand of blessing would be with us throughout this day, that we would have a sense of God's nearness to us. For as we've gathered in his name and in his house, we've called upon the living God to be with us, to lead us and to bless all that is to be undertaken today, that with grace and love and gentleness that we would do all such things, Lord, that we would embrace one another as friends, as family, as communities across the island, and that we'd know that when we're in your house, there's a special gift and a blessing to receive, and that we'd be all the poorer if we left this house without receiving God's blessing. So, Lord, in our act of worship and remembrance today, draw near to all. Comfort those who have their own sorrows to deal with. Speak to those, Lord, who are seeking help in life, seeking your counsel. May there be a word in season for some here today and those watching, that they will sense that God is with his people as he promised. Lord, this is the greatest blessing we know, to have you in our midst at this service and every time we gather in the name of our Lord Jesus. So pour out your blessing upon the family, the community, and cause our hearts, Lord, to be touched by the same love of Christ that Margaret's life was transformed by. We pray this will be the greatest gift and legacy from this service today, that some will be drawn to Christ and surrender to his great love. So forgive our sins and go before us in all that we do and say, for we ask it in Christ's name. Now, a short biblical reflection. The last chapter in the last book of the Bible, Revelation, begins this way. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street in the holy city, and then goes on to speak of the wonder of paradise. As a young man growing up on the island, the way ahead seemed to divide into two paths, each offering its own attraction and appeal. On the one hand, there was the way of the bottle, Ishkebeh, or the way of the church, where another Ishke Nebehe was offered, as I read from that portion. The water of life is the literal translation. And for many, the way of the bottle became a way of life. And the way of the church was rejected. For others, it was the opposite. The ways of the world were shunned and the way of faith was grasped. A community divided, maybe a rather sweeping generalization, but in the eyes of many, including my own, this is the choice that was on offer. And as one who has taken freely from the bottled version, I can speak with feeling and insight. It leaves one empty, depressed, even destitute if taken to excess. It drains energy and resources and gives nothing back except a fleeting feeling of elation. But as one who has freely taken of the water of life which Jesus offers, I can affirm that it is soul refreshing, reaches the parts that nothing else can reach, quenches the innermost thirst, and satisfies the deepest longing of life. And the invitation that the Bible gives to us is, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Rivers of living water will flow from within them. By this he meant the Spirit who would be given to those who believe. What a wonderful promise. And if I could further apply the words of Jesus as he spoke to the woman at the well, he said, everyone who drinks this water, the natural water, will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. And as the beautiful hymn puts it, O Christ, he is the fountain, the sweet, sweet well of love. The streams on earth I've tasted, more deep I'll drink above. There to an ocean fullness his mercy doth expand, and glory, glory dwelleth in Emmanuel's land. Our thoughts today, your thoughts, are of Margaret, who tasted the earthly blessings of knowing Jesus and experienced a deep joy in her soul. Now she has passed to that glory land where she will drink freely and fully of the life-giving stream of the water of life that flows from the throne of God. And for us today, the same offer is given to us. Let the one who is thirsty, this is at the very end of the Bible, let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life. So each of us here have a choice, which water of life we take, Ishkebeh or Ishkenebeh. This is God's gracious offer to us all, and we pray that God would draw your hearts to take the one that will satisfy your soul. Now, the final reading chosen by the family is a very, very, very relevant one as we have considered Margaret's practical love and the way she served the community. And it's from the Gospel of Matthew 25 towards the end. Matthew 25, 31 to 40. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was ill, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." And these words surely speak very much the epitome of who Margaret was, a very practical woman in her life. And so her legacy today, and what a beautiful presentation at the beginning of her life with photographs and music. So thank you for that. It has really added something special to our service today. So thank you for preparing that. So having heard all these words, we're all going to conclude with singing An Amazing Grace, after which we'll remain standing for the benediction. Of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest with those who have opened their heart to Him, and may God speak to each one of us of His love and the offer of salvation this day. Lord, may Your peace go before us, and may Your hand be upon us. Keep drawing us to Yourself, Lord, that we may resist no longer, but know Your grace and peace. Thank You for this special hour today, Father. We treasure these times, though the occasion is not what we would choose. But we thank You that You've been here to bless, to encourage our hearts. So may we depart now with that sense of peace, love, and joy that is given through Christ Jesus, in whose name we ask. Amen. So feel free to move out. Oh yes, the collection for Alzheimer's on both doors. You can wish to come out that side or the front door. So.
And tea. Tea's in the back.
Thank you, Kenny. Information, stay in the back. Just know if anyone wants to stay, but come back later for the teas and coffee. So feel free to move once the family have gone down. Thank you.